Albert Camus once said that your life is a slow trek, a slow journey. To recover the two or three images whose presence your heart first moved your heart. Let me say it again. Your life is the slow trek to recover the two or three simple images in whose presence your heart first moved. Sebastian Moore recovered one of those images after he had wandered into a church at Vespers. He'd had a lot of spaghetti, a lot of pasta, and a lot of sauce, and a lot of wine. But he wandered into Vespers, and this is a monk, I should tell you. He wandered into Vespers on the Feast of the Sacred Heart. In his book, The Inner Loneliness, Sebastian Moore describes that moment of awakening in him. As I entered the church, he wrote, I heard these words, these familiar words in Latin, and he recites them in the book in Latin, in English. One of the soldiers opened his side with a spear, and immediately there came out blood and water. And I had, he said, what can only be described as a sense of fullness of truth. Somehow everything that was to be said about life and its renewing was in those words and in that image. Somehow my life, my destiny, was in those words and in that image. Do you see your life in the words and in the image? In the spearing of Christ's side on the cross, in the blood, but also the water that heals and restores and renews, flowing from his side. There are sights impossible to forget, says a blogger that I've been following, who is he's an architect and he is a photographer. His name is Dennis Aubrey. Wonderful, wonderful blog and also a website devoted to architecture, church architecture. Wonderful, beautiful architecture. And his words are also beautiful. The words that accompany his photographs. Dennis Aubrey tells a story about walking into a basilica. It's the basilica of the Magdalene, of Mary Magdalene, the story of the pouring out of the expensive ointment, remember, is often thought to be the act of Mary Magdalene. He writes, there are sights impossible to forget. The first glimpse of your child, or the look on the face of your beloved at a moment of perfect happiness. Those images are easy to call up. They stay with us. My first sight of Vizalay, I'm not sure, I don't speak French. I had a course in high school and I almost flunked it. So you'll have to forgive my pronunciation. Vizalay was such a moment of perfection. This is where this wonderful Basilica of the Magdalene is. Was such a moment of perfection for me, he wrote, a small medieval town clustered on a steep hill with a single narrow road winding its way up to the top of the rise where stands the Basilica of Mary Magdalene. To appreciate Vizelay is to watch sunlight move like a living thing across walls of stone, and then suddenly create a vision of indescribable, aching beauty. It is to watch shadows deepen around a priest sitting solitary in a side chapel, waiting patiently for a penitent to come for confession. It is to hear the songs of nuns echo off the vaulted ceiling and ring like bells in the human soul. David sang in the Psalms, "You, O Lord, will be my light. By you, my God, the dark will be made bright for me." And in Vizelay, this is palpable. You can feel it. You can see it. You can touch it. "So many days," he writes, "I have brought my camera equipment into the church and have seen and captured images that make me wonder if it is even us taking the pictures. I wonder whether it is I who am taking the pictures. It is enough to sit and watch and wait, and suddenly the shot appears as if summoned by the Magdalene herself. It has never failed to occur, and I don't imagine that it ever will. In September 2008, at the end of 2 full days of shooting in the church, I sat on the stone wall leading down to the crypt where Mary Magdalene's relics have been kept for so long, venerated by many. The originals, her original relics, were destroyed," he writes, "in the paroxysm of the French Revolution, but new ones have been placed in this crypt and are visited to this day. I was quieted and trying to remain inconspicuous because the priest was in the side chapel of St. Teresa of Avila hearing confession. Every once in a while, a young man or an elderly woman would come and sit next to him on a small wooden stool. With heads huddled together, they would murmur quiet words of repentance and forgiveness. At the end, a sign of blessing, and then footsteps echoed on the flagstones. It seemed to me, sitting near, the church was silent and reverent, fulfilling its very purpose, even if it was only a single person seeking the expiation of sins. In this silence, a new thought entered my consciousness, something never expressed before. With this thought came a tumult of emotions, a release of waves of images and thoughts and feelings. I suddenly understood the need for God. Even if I did not acknowledge that need for myself, I knew with certainty that it existed. It was a terrifying moment, unsettling and disturbing. I struggled to lock this transient understanding firmly in my mind so as not to forget, so that it did not turn into a mere anecdote. After some time, a sound entered my consciousness, emanating from the pillars, the walls, the arches, from the blocks of granite themselves. I don't know how long I sat there, rapt, listening, as the flow coursed through me in a flood that grew in intensity And all the while, this faint sound of music. Eventually, I became aware of being watched, of not being alone in my thoughts. I turned to see a young priest standing next to me with a small and knowing smile. Er chante, Père, I said. Er chante à jour, oui. She sings, Father. She sings today. And his smile broadened, and he nodded, and he went off down the aisle, leaving me with my thoughts. And on this day, Magdalene was singing. And the very stones rang with her song. On the way to his death, when they told his disciples to be quiet, Jesus said, if they keep silence, the very stones will ring out, and they still do. Amen.